We already know the story, right? There was before this, if you look at this diagram, we had source code. Just a minute. We had source code, which was given as input to the lexical analyzer. Right? And lexical analyzer was giving output a list of token or a sequence of token to the parser and parser. Then you have seen the static checker, okay? And after static checking, okay, we will have this part, intermediate code generator. Okay, this intermediate code is, we can say, well formatted instruction based on what the real machine code can be generated in case of compilers. Okay, so you can understand this intermediate code is not machine code, okay, or it is not any kind of programming language. You can say usually it is not a programming language, and this code is also not the machine code or some other kind of programming language code. But this is some kind of simple representation of complex instruction or syntax tree and all what we have analyzed and found in by doing parser and parsing and say static checker and all these things, right? So you'll find one thing we call this from here to this intermediate code generation as the front end of the compiler, and beyond that we call as back end of the compiler. Reason is that for doing this front end part, it doesn't matter on which machine you are working. You can use any hardware, so it can be also called as machine independent part. This part can be called as machine independent part. But if you see up to beyond this line, the back end, here the real executable codes are going to be generated, like machine code. Okay, or if it is not machine code, it can be say byte code. Okay. So this kind of things can be generated here, and which can be definitely based on the machine, that based on the target machine, on which machine these codes are going to execute. Based on that machine you have to generate this code. So these are called machine dependent. Okay, so these are called machine dependent part. I think you already understand, right? Why this part is machine dependent? Reason is that, say, your code is going to run on a 64-bit machine. That means you have to generate your, target machine code such way so that it should support 64-bit processor. But no, say you have a 16-bit processor, 32-bit processor, then this machine code must be compatible with 32-bit processor, right? So if you have generated some machine code for a 32-bit processor, you will not be able to run it on 64-bit machine. Okay, so these things you need to understand why this is called machine dependent part and why this is called machine independent part. Okay, but these are the analysis which are basically soft analysis. There is no relation between all these protected analysis and you can say the machine on which it is going to execute. Okay. So a compiler might use a sequence of intermediate representations. So there can be sequence of intermediate representation between the source program and the target code. Okay, so you are giving as input this, so this is the input to compiler, right? This is the target code is the output from the compiler. But the compiler in between here, if you see, I'm not showing all the phases of the compiler, but here the compiler can use multiple intermediate representation or multiple intermediate codes. So each intermediate representation can be called as intermediate code. Okay, so based on the situation, it can do it. Like so you have given some complex instruction like this: A equal to B plus C multiplication D and say minus 4. Quite long instruction. So that can be first split into small operations. Okay, that can be called as three address code. You'll see what is three address code. Okay, and that can be again converted from three address to assembly code. Okay, then this assembly code may be again converted to machine code or target code. Say, if the target code is is machine language code, then here we can have assembler. This assembly code can then be converted to machine code. Okay, with the help of assembler here. Okay, since so machine many programming language, this architecture is being followed. Okay. Next, one of the representation called which is quite similar with the syntax tree. So it is a variant of syntax tree called DAG. What is DAG? It is directed acyclic graph. Okay, so what is DAG? Directed acyclic graph. Okay, so why it is called directed acyclic graph? Because in DAG we allow, even it is a graph, it is directed, and in this we allow cycles. Okay, so it is sometimes beneficial to create a DAG instead of tree for an expression. So still now what we have created is syntax tree. In syntax tree, it will not have this kind of if you see this kind of cycles. So tree does not have cycles, but graph may have, right? So if you generate tree, you can't generate these cycles. Why do we need cycles? I will tell you later. Okay, expression identifies the common sub expression. So what happens here, this A maybe appear in a expression, say here if you look, two times, but here only one node is created with name A. Okay, and whenever it is needed to use A, it is simply pointed to this single A. Okay, so A is a sub expression here, and in the DAG we create one instance of each sub expression. Okay, so sub expression that occur more than once, we merge them. Okay, so what is sub expression? Basically, those are the treated, those expression, the part of the expression is treated as sub expression which are occurring more than one time. Like you can see here, B minus C, again here we have a B minus C. So B minus C is a sub expression here. Okay, so this way we can easily show the common sub expression and then use the knowledge during code generation. Because if you do this, you will have an optimized code. Right, you will use less amount of memory, because, and another thing, you are not going to generate redundant variable, right? Because it doesn't matter how many times this B is appearing in this expression, this B and this B are referring to same value, right? It must have same value. So when it will be, it will be maintained in the computer, in the programming environment, only when these two things will belongs to same memory location. Right. these two bee must these two bees must point to same memory location, then only it can be assured, right? So this is the reason why we need to have this directed acyclic graph before we generate or we go for intermediate code generation. Okay, so I think we understand that for many optimization and avoiding of generating multiple instance or you can say allocating memory for multiple memory location for a single variable to which will actually lead us to behave the same variable like different, because they have been if they are going to be assigned different memory location for different instances. Okay, so to control all these things, we can do this. Okay, better to do a DAG so that we can we can merge all the duplicate appearance of particular expression and sub expressions, and we can use. Okay, now how it is related to syntax tree, right? This DAG, how it is related to syntax tree and how we can generate it. Okay, so if you recall our discussion of the previous previous day's discussion, then you may have recall this. There was expression a minus 4 plus c, right? And there was a grammar, and we had discussed like that e is a variable, grammar variable, so e dot node will have a process which will generate e dot node plus t dot node, and t dot node will just call or read id. Okay, here t dot node can also read a number. Okay, and e dot node can lead you to t dot node, and this t dot node can read id. Okay, so this is a kind of this happens by doing parsing. We understand, right? Using parsing, we can do this using the parse technique, right? Using parsing technique, we can generate this, but parsing techniques gives you only these variable names. Like, if you just parse for this, it will give you parse table like e to e plus t, right? Then e to t, t to id it will give, and sorry, here we have minus and t, and this t will give you num, and this t will give you id. So this is what called a syntax tree. Generate a syntax tree, converted a syntax tree by using some semantic rule with this and associated with this grammar. I think you have remember, you can remember this discussion about semantic rule, right? So if you have semantic rule, like it can have like this e dot node to e dot dot node plus t dot node, right? Then this rule will give us this. Okay, and this dot node basically a process which creates a new node. Okay, so it creates a new node. Okay, so it will look like this. So this parse tree will look like this. Okay, now what this node will do? This node will generate a node. This is a node, you can say, generated like a small array with three element, you can say. Okay, first element is operator, second element is the left child address, or it is a pointer, and this is say child address or pointer to right child. Okay, and this is having operator. Okay, and definitely this left child address will later give left operand right? Left operand, and this right child address will later give right operand for this operator, right? So this is the concept of what this node process does for E. Okay, so it creates a node like this, okay, with a data structure. Say then there is another E dot node here. So E dot node here comes, okay, it brings the operand, the operator which was here, it this brings to here, right? And it also have two part, left child and right child pointer. Okay, this left child pointer points to some ID, which ID will later read the entry for A. And we know this, you know, A is a variable name which is identifier. So identifier in symbol table are entered as ID, right? So it is a given ID and some memory address it pointer to the, you know, entry of this ID or value of this ID. Okay, and here is you can say num, and it don't need a pointer because if this number 4 is already defined here, so it is constant is put it in memory and put it just linked to this. Okay, and this ID is pointing to C. So if you look at this part, okay, if you look at this part, what we are going to have, you will find that it is nothing but a simple syntax tree. Here we have plus, here we have minus, this and this. Okay, so this is what looking like syntax tree. What is what happens in a syntax tree? In syntax trees, we know the nodes are operator, and in an arithmetic way of speaking about, the nodes are basically operator, and the leaves are the values. Okay, so here syntax tree for this given expression can be like this. New, you know, P1, that is process 1, is generating new leaf, creating a leaf ID entry for A. So this part is done. Then process 2 is creating another new leaf, another leaf it is creating, which is number and with constant 4. So this is generated. Once we have the left and right child, we can have this operator, right, minus. So new, we can generate a new node, which is, you know, operator is this, left operand is P1, that means which is coming from the P1, and right operand is P2, which is coming from here. So we can do this, okay? So operator is minus, and this one part is going to, you know, going to point to P1, and another is going to point to P2, okay, and so on. So it will give this part, this syntax tree. This is the way how we generate.